Morning, and good morning to all of our friends in video land. We know you're here, there. Hi. Today is December the 14th. That meant that yesterday was December 13th, which meant that we had 12, 13, 14. Who knew? All right, what's that have to do with the sermon? Not a whole lot, but I just thought I'd mention that for those that are numerologists. Bah, humbug! Ali, that was my attitude about Christmas. Bah, humbug! That's the way I felt about it. But I called myself a Christian back in the day. But when it came to Christmas, bah, humbug. Yeah, there was a time when I totally avoided personally celebrating Christmas. I wanted my worship to be pure. I felt that God needed and wanted pure, unadulterated, truth-filled worship without all the trappings of these so-called Christian holidays. And as a teenager, when I was beginning to study this and hearing all this from my former instruction in church and theology, people said, well, in my studies, it showed that Christians shouldn't be celebrating Christmas because it was pagan. Yeah, and there I was, all of 14, 15 years old. Yeah, it's pagan. I didn't know what pagan meant, but, you know, it sounded bad. So as I learned a little bit more about what pagan worship meant, it had to do with idolatry and worshiping false gods and superstition and error. So outside of my professional work as a musician, I totally poo-pooed the celebration of Christmas. I was a religious Scrooge, so to speak. Christmas, bah, humbug. No Christmas tree for me. No exchanging of gifts for me. In fact, my mother thought I was in a cult. She worried that her son was going off on the deep end. From what I could tell, she just waited to hear the news any day now that her son was on some mountaintop waiting on a spaceship to come down out of the sky and take him to heaven. Bah, humbug, Christmas. Well, you know, I was a part of a belief system that many shared, and actually many, many shared in the early days of our history. And that's what I'm going to talk about today, a Christian's attitude toward Christmas. You see, today I've changed. I don't treat the holiday the same. But it's because of an understanding of the nature of a loving God who's seen his people struggle with Christmas and other practices of the faith since the church began. But let's look at Christians and Christmas, particularly how it came to be a particularly American holiday. And maybe this will shed some light on the holiday that's become the most singularly important holiday of not only Christians, but of non-Christians in the whole country, and inevitably all over the world. And just what we ought to be thinking about as our nation celebrates this venerated holiday. Well, first of all, I'm going to take you way, way back. Maybe I will. Got this note here. Yeah. In the early 17th century, a wave of religious reform changed the way Christmas was celebrated in Europe. When Oliver Cromwell and his Puritan forces took over England in 1645, they vowed to rid England of decadence. And as a part of that, they canceled Christmas. Imagine that. Somebody canceled Christmas? By popular demand, Charles II was restored to the throne, and with him came the return of Christmas. Well, the Pilgrims were English separatists, and they came to America in 1620, And they were even more orthodox in their Puritan beliefs than Cromwell. As a result, Christmas was not a holiday in early America. From 1659 to 1681, the celebration of Christmas was actually outlawed in Boston. Imagine that, being arrested for keeping Christmas in America. Well, that's the way it was. So back in my teenage years, when I was learning about this, I was on the side with the righteous Puritans. Yes. Anyway, anybody exhibiting the Christmas spirit was fined 5 shillings. Now, how would you be illustrating the Christmas spirit? I guess everybody had to look really sullen and sad December 25th, because if you had a smile on your face, you might be fine with paying 5 shillings for looking too happy during Christmas time. Well, by contrast, in Jamestown, Captain John Smith reported that Christmas was enjoyed by all and passed without incident. So, as you can see, in America, there were some regions, no Christmas, other areas, Christmas, but it was not a nationally recognized holiday. After the American Revolution, the English customs fell out of favor, including Christmas. In fact, Congress was in session on December the 25th, the first Christmas in 1789 under America's new Constitution. Christmas was not declared a federal holiday until, anybody want to guess what year? 1Anybody venture to guess, Curtis?
I don't have a clue.
Oh. 1870. Christmas was declared a national federal holiday. So it wasn't until basically the 19th century that Americans began to embrace Christmas. In fact, Americans reinvented Christmas and changed it from a raucous carnival holiday into a family-centered day of peace and nostalgia. 1870. So, before 1850, many U.S. citizens, as I said before, did not dream of Christmas at all. And what was happening is that as we progressed in our history, we started going through things like industrialization and lots of immigrants coming in, and most of all, a civil war. Well, the Civil War was a time that Christmas was actually used as a propaganda tool. Abraham Lincoln had a painting commissioned of Santa Claus giving comfort to the Union soldiers. And this was nationally advertised as a great symbol of what Christmas was all about. Can you imagine being in Louisiana and Mississippi and Florida and some of the southern states and seeing this painting of Santa Claus embracing the Union soldiers and not the southern soldiers? Well, the North and the South were quite divided on this issue of Christmas, as well as on the question of slavery. Many Northerners first saw a celebration of Christmas as a sin. To these people, the celebration of Thanksgiving was more appropriate. But gradually, in the South, Christmas became an important part of the social season. And this was not surprising in that they were suffering in war and they wanted to have the solace and the comfort of a holiday to bring the family back together and all their injured and war-weary veterans. So the first state in the South in 1836 to declare Christmas a legal holiday was my state, Alabama, 1836. And then Louisiana followed with in 1838 and Arkansas. So in the years after the Civil War, Christmas traditions spread all around the country. Children's books played an important role in the celebration, and many of the traditions developed that we still have today. Well, I thought I'd share with you some of the beginnings of those traditions, and it will kind of help you to appreciate a little bit more of what Christmas, how Christmas was celebrated amongst the people of the United States. Okay, going to give you a quick overview here. In 1809, Washington Irving, writing under the pseudonym of Dietrich Knickerbocker, included St. Nicholas in his book, A History of New York. Nicholas was described as riding through town on a horse. In 1812, Irving revised the book and had Nicholas riding over trees on a horse. Then in 1821, William Gilley printed a poem about Santa Claus, who was dressed in fur and drove a sleigh drawn by one reindeer. In 1822, a dentist named Clark Moore believed to have written a poem called An Account of a Visit of St. Nicholas, better known as "'Twas the Night Before Christmas." In this, Santa's portrayed as an elf with a miniature sleigh equipped with 8 itty-bitty reindeer, which are named Blitzen, Comet, Cupid, Dancer, Dasher, Donder, Prancin, Vixen. No Rudolph, not yet. In 1841, Parkinson, J.W. Parkinson, a Philadelphia merchant, hired a man to dress up in a Santa Claus outfit and climb the chimney of his store. That was always something I wondered about as a little kid growing up in Alabama. Mama said Santa Claus was going to come down the chimney. And all we had was a little old bitty air vent at the top of my roof. I just kept wondering, how is he going to do that? But you know, you just accept whatever they say, especially when you're going to get a bicycle. Okay. In 1860, President Abraham Lincoln asked illustrator Thomas Nast to create a drawing of Santa Claus with the Union soldiers. This image demoralized the influence of the Confederate Army. And this was an example of psychological warfare. In 1897, Francis Church, the editor of the Sun, the New York Sun, wrote an editorial response to a letter from an 8-year-old girl named Virginia Ohanian. She had written the paper asking whether there really was a Santa Claus. It's become known as, "Yes, Virginia, there is a Santa Claus." So all of these things continued to happen as the idea of Christmas and Santa Claus began to take hold in America. And yet, there were people that felt like I did. Bah, humbug about Christmas. It was not something that we Christians were supposed to do. And because of that, it caused some religious folks to totally, you know, give up on this idea of celebrating this holiday. Well, what were some of the objections that we Christians developed regarding Christmas? Well, I'm going to outline about 4 of them right here. The first argument is that Christmas is too commercialized and materialistic. Second argument, Scripture does not authorize Christmas. Third argument, Scripture forbids it. And fourth argument, Christian traditions are from paganism. Well, as I said before, I experienced a change in my attitude about Christmas. And I'm proud to say, for 35 years, didn't celebrate it at all. And then something happened about 2 years ago. My wife's relatives came to visit. And they wanted a Christmas tree. We borrowed a Christmas tree. I did not go cut down one in the forest. We borrowed a plastic one. It was pretty, pretty cool, these plastic ones. Huge, huge tree. And it was all bundled up. And you take the cover off of it, and it's like these arms just pop up almost. And you have this automatic Christmas tree sitting in the living room. So the relatives were coming, which included a couple of teenage girls, and my wife's niece and my wife's sister and her husband. And they wanted Christmas at the Gibbs home. The first time in 35 years at my home celebrating Christmas. It was a weird, weird feeling. So, folks, they didn't just want a Christmas tree. They wanted presents under the Christmas tree. I never did this for 35 years. This was really strange. This was hard for me to deal with this. So everybody was supposed to buy presents for every other person, and we got all the gifts, and they were all wrapped up in boxes. I hadn't seen anything like this since I was like 10 years old growing up in Alabama when we celebrated as a family. But not only that, they also wanted to put stockings on the fireplace. Never had stockings on the fireplace. So we got these stockings. And not only that, they put stuff in the stockings. They put little gifts and boxes and stuff inside. My house was turning into a pagan festival. And not only that, they wanted to celebrate it 2 days. So one day, on Christmas Eve, we celebrated and we had the toys and things put under the tree and all the gifts. And they wanted to do something else, which I'd never heard of before. They wanted to have reindeer food spread out on the yard. I said, what's reindeer food? Well, we didn't do that in Alabama. But these people from Indiana, that's, you know, up north, they do things differently. But anyway, reindeer food was this glitter, and we had ice on the yard that season, so they put this glitter out on the snow, which supposedly was to be eaten by the reindeer when they came to visit us and come down our little bitty chimney, well, Santa Claus. And not only that, but we had this huge Christmas meal, which was very, very good, I must say. And we opened our gifts on Christmas, and it was just wonderful. Everybody got all kinds of gifts. I really didn't buy anything, but my wife bought things for us to give to everybody else. And it was nice. It was sweet. It was loving. It was family. It was Norman Rockwell. It was nostalgic. It was good. I'm not doing it this year, but it was good. But against the backdrop of all that were these haunting memories of my disdain and abstaining from Christmas because of those four reasons that I just mentioned. So Christmas, the attitude of Christians. Christmas is commercialized and materialistic. It's said that because the birth of Jesus has been commercialized and secularized, that the real meaning of the season has been lost for the most part. That's true. Even the story about the birth of Christ is often distorted and mocked and misrepresented. You know, they didn't have the three wise men, you know, at the manger scene. That was later on, you know, and there's nothing in the scripture about angels and cows and horses and pigs and stuff all around the manger. You know, it's kind of created stuff. And, you know, Jesus probably didn't have this like sun halo over his head, you know, and Mary and Joseph, you know, and all those little things that have been added. You know, it does make you wonder about whether it's just, you know, the meaning of this so-called season has been lost. Besides, you know, Christ probably wasn't born on December 25th. We don't know when he was born. So how can we just claim that he was born? It's just become such a holiday that we are missing the full meaning of Jesus' coming to the earth. Well, if we use this argument as a reason for discarding the entire celebration of Christ's birth at Christmas, maybe since the Bible doesn't say we're supposed to keep Christmas, maybe that means that We're supposed to get rid of marriage and food and the church, all these kinds of things that the Bible doesn't actually tell you. Actually, these things that people do that have ruined the meaning of it. Maybe that's, you know, people are misusing sex, so that means, hey, just get rid of sex, get rid of marriage, we're messing up in the church, we're overeating, we're doing all kinds of things that have nothing to do with the way God wants us to operate. Name one thing that Satan doesn't ruin. We don't throw these things out just because the world misuses them or distorts them. And some point to a scripture in 1 Thessalonians 5:22 says, Paul says, abstain from every form of evil, including Santa Claus. No, he didn't say that, but every form of evil. Well, King James Version says every appearance of evil, and some have taken this to mean that anything that even looks like it might be evil. But a modern translation of that scripture says, Paul is telling us to abstain from every genuine form of evil, not what might simply appear to be evil, but what is actually genuinely evil and wrong according to the Word of God. Another scripture, Titus 1:15, the apostle warns against those who see evil in almost anything and condemn it. For these people, a lot of things have the appearance of evil, but purity is first of all a matter of the mind and conscience, not merely the external. So he writes, to the pure, all things are pure, but to those who are defiled and unbelieving, nothing is pure, but both their mind and their conscience are defiled. So just because the world distorts something, that does not make it evil of itself. So we need to make sure that we avoid using that kind of an argument. Because to the pure, all things are pure. And that Christmas was a nice get-together with the family. And once I got out of my bah humbug spirit, I was able to appreciate it. Well, what about the point that Scripture doesn't authorize it? Well, Scripture doesn't authorize PowerPoint, using musical instruments, hymn books, church buildings, pews, Sunday school, many other things that we've adopted as traditions and things that we do to honor our Lord. Sometimes mountains are made out of molehills and the truth is missed. So I could see that argument too. Another one says that Scripture forbids it. Colossians 2:16, verse 17, therefore let no one act as your judge in regard to food and drink or in respect to the festival or the new moon or the Sabbath day. Things that are mere shadow of what is to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. In this scripture, it's not forbidding the celebration of religious seasons or holy days. It's forbidding judging other believers for what they're doing to honor Christ in their own way. So it's the reason, it's the attitude, it's the spirit to which it's done. You know, my mom was wringing her hands, worrying about me as a young man, thinking that, you know, one day she might see me in a Jim Jones situation, drinking the Kool-Aid with some cult. And I often think about that, you know, how I could have handled that a lot better, just in terms of keeping her mind at ease and at peace, and not just being so self-righteous that I made her practice of keeping the holiday seem like it was something that was weird and wrong and sinful. It could have resulted in a lot more peace in my family in those days. The last thing is that Christian traditions are from paganism. And I would say true, there are many things that we are doing with the celebration of Christmas that have their origin in things that pagans and unbelievers did. But that doesn't mean that we are worshiping in the same way. That doesn't mean that we're bowing down to that tree that they built in the Old Testament in Jeremiah, it speaks about that in Isaiah. Doesn't mean that we're worshiping the tree or the Yule log. It means that we're actually just using traditional items in the celebration of the Lord's birth. Well, a lot of these arguments have been reconsidered by me, and I've come to appreciate the celebration of the holiday and not feel so Scrooge about it. And I want to close with a few pointers that God gives us in the scriptures that help me to appreciate the holiday in a different light. And let's look at Romans 14. Romans 14, verse 14 says, "Except the one whose faith is weak, who's quarreling over quarreling over disputable matters." In verse 2, "One person's faith allows them to eat anything, but another, whose faith is weak, he's a vegetarian. The one who eats everything must not treat with contempt the one who doesn't. The one who does not eat everything mustn't judge the one who does, for God has accepted them. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? Do their own masters, servants, stand or fall? And they will stand, for the Lord is able to make them stand. One person considers one day more sacred than another. Another considers every day alike. Each of them should be fully convinced in their own mind." In verse 13, "Therefore, let us stop passing judgment on one another. Instead, make up your mind not to put any stumbling block or obstacle in the way of your brother or sister. I'm convinced, being fully persuaded in the Lord Jesus, that nothing is unclean of itself, but if anyone regards something as unclean, then for that person it is unclean. Hence, if we have Christian brothers in our midst that don't want to have anything to do with this holiday, that's fine. We have brothers and sisters that just want to go whole hog and just keep the holiday, as long as they're not, you know, overtly doing sinful things or promoting bad behavior, so be it. I'm convinced, being fully persuaded in the Lord, that nothing is unclean in itself. But if anyone regards something as unclean, then for that person it is unclean. If your brother or sister is distressed because of what you eat, you're no longer acting in love. Do not by your eating destroy someone for whom Christ died. Therefore, do not let what you know is good be spoken of as evil. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking and Christmas and holidays and things like that, but of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Because anyone who serves Christ in this way is pleasing to God and receives human approval. Let us therefore make every effort to do what leads to peace and to mutual edification. Do not destroy the work of God for the sake of food or Christmas." Well, I think that says it all. And as we celebrate this season, or some choose not to, let us all keep in mind that we are brothers and sisters in the Lord. Jesus was born, Jesus did live, and he died for the sins of all mankind. And we can rejoice in that, and we can sing joy to the world, not only in December, but throughout the whole year because of that truth. And as we speak about joy, we're going to light a candle. Of course, I haven't done much of this, you know, for 35 years. I didn't do this kind of stuff. Joy. Like a gun, huh? Press the button. Hey! All right, we lit two candles before, and our third candle today is going to be, which one?
Pink one.
The pink one. That's joy telling me about the candle of joy. All right. As we keep a tradition of the Advent season, recognizing that Jesus came, and that is a reason for joy for all of us. Christians all over this world are recognizing the fact that Jesus came and God loved the world and he gave his son so that we could all have eternal life. So let's pray. Eternal Father, thank you so much for giving us more knowledge of who you are and how we're supposed to live our lives. We thank you for the advent of Jesus, that he came to this earth, that it truly was a fact that he was here and walked this earth, that he lived an example for all of us to follow. We thank you for the brothers and sisters that we have, not only in this congregation, but in congregations throughout many, many denominations throughout the whole world. And we know that one day we're all going to come to a total knowledge of who you are and your purpose and plan for mankind. Until then, Lord, please unite us in our worship and help us to grow in love for you, love for one another, and love for a world that needs the truth of Jesus' coming more so than ever before. We thank you now and turn the rest of this day into your hands, and we ask you, God, to strengthen us and guide us through another week. And thank you so much for the coming of Jesus as we celebrate it in our lives, not only in December, but throughout the year. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.